everybody. Thanks for tuning in to DNews. I'm Trace. Today we're going to do something a little bit different, though you probably realize that already. We're going to talk about the science of fog, how it's formed, and why it is that San Francisco gets so much of it. We're also going to look at technologies designed to harness fog and infrastructure that we've built in order to deal with it. But to do that, we probably have to go outside. It's a little foggy in here. San Francisco is sometimes known as Fog City, and yeah, it gets foggy, but it's not really San Francisco's fault, it's the Pacific Ocean's fault. Fog forms over the ocean and then floats over the city, but it also floats over the nearby redwood forests, which might not exist without it. Here on Mount Tamalpais State Park, just north of San Francisco, are a number of redwood groves. California redwoods, or Sequoia sempervirens, have different leaves scattered throughout their structure. Pinnacle leaves near the top are actually better at absorbing water than their relatives towards the base of the tree. This nourishes the massive trees, especially during the summer months when fog is the most prevalent. In fact, fog alone can provide up to 40% of redwoods' moisture intake. Redwood trees' unique ability to ingest water higher in their canopy may be why they can grow to such great heights in the more foggy areas of the Pacific Northwest than they do further south where it's drier. Due to their size and color, redwood trees are almost unmistakable. In fact, redwood trees have even been used as navigation points for sailors in the San Francisco Bay. Until about 1851, sailors would use redwoods located in Oakland as navigation trees to avoid striking the submerged Blossom Rock, a major hazard to the west of Yerba Buena Island in the San Francisco Bay. Redwoods aren't the only indicators used by mariners to navigate the tricky Northern California coastlines through the fog. Lighthouses, such as the Point Bonita Lighthouse here, are a technologically primitive navigation tool by today's standards, but provide a fail-safe should onboard GPS or radar equipment fail a captain at sea. Today, the Point Bonita Lighthouse uses both its light and foghorns to warn nearby ships of the periphery of the Golden Gate entrance. Just like these technologies have evolved to ensure the safety of marine vessels, so have technologies to study and harness the fog. Another iconic San Francisco landmark, mainly used to broadcast television, is Sutro Tower. You are now at the very top of Sutro Tower, dangling off one of the main catwalks. The tower is located just southwest of downtown San Francisco. This unique location as a midpoint between the warmer climate of the San Francisco Bay and the cooler climate of the Pacific Ocean makes it perfect for meteorologists hoping to find out how fog is formed along the California coastline. Scientists have used Sutro Tower to study how fog moves, take wind measurements, and reveal how these massive waves of moisture are put together. Even today, fog catching continues, with moisture from the fog trapped in small quantities for use at a local distillery. Although these fog catchers aren't very large and they don't capture much moisture, similar technology is used at larger installations in other parts of the world, such as the driest place on Earth, the Atacama Desert. There, researchers are hoping the fog catchers can actually provide enough potable water for local families in the near future. The scientists and inventors behind fog catchers may or may not have borrowed ideas from redwood trees when coming up with new sources of harvesting water, but it illustrates how we can learn from these ancient flora as we embark on a clearer path towards a new sustainable technology. And perhaps, if we do so, our future will be a little bit brighter.